The universe is big. Everyone knows that. But you're probably used to seeing it in a diagram something like this. But that doesn't really tell the full story of how the scale of it works. It all fits in the diagram nicely, perfect to print on a poster and stick up on the wall. But in order to make that happen, things are very much not to scale. I mean, what if we actually had things to scale? Let's see how that would go. Given exactly how big the distances involved are, I think we'll pick a scale of about 1 to a billion. Each meter is a billion meters, so each millimeter represents about 1,000 kilometers. Now, Earth would be roughly a 13-millimeter dot. Seemed reasonable, right? Any smaller, and it wouldn't really be visible on a poster. But where's the Sun? Now, the problem here is at the same scale, the Sun is going to be about 1.4 meters in diameter. That's, of course, a bit of a problem for fitting it on such a poster. I mean, we can work around this and maybe just say, show the edge of it or something. But here's the thing, if we want to use the same kind of scale for distance to make this both to scale for size and to scale for distance, this is not nearly as much of a problem as compared to where we'd have to put it. In order for this to be accurate, that actually belongs 150 meters that way. And the outermost object in our solar system, the formerly known as a dwarf planet Pluto, well, that's about 6 kilometers that way, in the next suburb over. So clearly you're not going to be able to get this on a poster. Someone would have to, like, build this with physical models, preferably along some sort of long path that makes them all easily accessible to get to. Well, it turns out that there is such a thing in Melbourne, so let's go have a look at it. In 2008, a temporary exhibition was set up to build such a thing, but it became so popular the council decided to commission proper statues to make it permanent. So here we are on the Bay Trail, or at least the part of it in St Kilda. This 1.4 meter ball... Sorry, I wrote the script before I noticed it had gone missing. But this 1.4 meter ball represents the Sun and the start of the trail. Making up almost 99.9% of the total mass of the solar system, its gravity keeps everything else in orbit. Mercury is the first planet in the solar system. It's approximately the size of the Earth's moon, and similar to it, has no atmosphere. It's 430 degrees in the sun, and minus 180 in the shade, hot enough to boil and freeze the normally liquid at room temperature metal named after it. Venus, the second planet in the solar system, despite being further away than Mercury, has a similar surface temperature, due to its atmosphere being 96.5% carbon dioxide at 92 times the pressure of Earth's atmosphere. That atmosphere has clouds, but they don't rain water, they rain sulfuric acid. The Russian Venera 13 spacecraft landed on Venus, lasting about 2 hours before it stopped functioning, but managing to bring us some of the only images of the planet we have. Earth. Well, you know Earth. The only one of the planets to support life, that we know of. Far enough away from the Sun that all the water on Earth doesn't boil, and close enough to the Sun that it doesn't freeze. Mars, the red planet. Named such because its surface is so red. It's made of very iron-rich rocks. It has an atmosphere, but a very thin one at that, at about 1% the density of Earth's, and mostly carbon dioxide. Surface temperature is minus 128 degrees at its lowest, but reaches about 35 degrees at the equator in summer. Sounds positively survivable compared to some of the other planets, if you bring your own oxygen, that is. Jupiter follows this, the largest planet in the solar system. It likely has no surface to speak of, just a smooth transition between a very heavy atmosphere and a liquid core. Anything which descends into the atmosphere will be crushed long before it reaches any kind of surface. Jupiter has 80 known moons, possibly more as some have only recently been discovered. Although Saturn is the planet most famous for its rings, Jupiter actually has a very faint ring system around it. One of the moons, Ganymede, is actually larger than the planet Mercury. Saturn is the sixth planet, and the second largest after Jupiter. Like Jupiter, it's also a gas giant. The planet is most notable for its rings, mostly made up of ice. It has 83 known moons, of which 53 have been officially named, but there are hundreds more moonlets located in the rings. Titan, the largest of the moons, is actually larger than Mercury and is the only known moon to have any significant atmosphere, mostly nitrogen, but at 1.5 times the atmospheric pressure of Earth. Uranus, the planet with the funny name. Some say that it should be pronounced more like Uranos, as that would have been closer to the pronunciation of the Greek god of the sky that it's named after. It's commonly thought of as pretty small, but after all, compared to Jupiter and Saturn, it is. But compared to Earth, it's actually 4 times larger. Along with Neptune, it's typically referred to as an ice giant. It was the first planet to be discovered in recorded history by Sir William Herschel in 1781, who initially thought it was a comet. It has the coldest atmosphere of all the known planets, getting down to minus 224 degrees Celsius, and its axis of rotation is practically tilted sideways, putting its north and south pole where most planets have their equator. Neptune, although slightly smaller than the preceding planet, is actually slightly more dense, due in part to gravitational compression of the atmosphere. This is the first planet not to be visible to the unaided naked eye, and this was the first to be found mathematically by analysing the orbits of other planets rather than observing it directly. Neptune's atmosphere, unlike its neighbour, has much more visible atmospheric weather systems. From the date of its discovery in 1846 until the discovery of Pluto in 1930, Neptune was the furthest known planet from the Sun. In the year 1979, due to Pluto's orbit being eccentric or oval-shaped, Pluto's orbit brought it closer into the Sun than Neptune, and now Neptune was the furthest planet from the Sun. In 1999, this changed back when Pluto became the furthest planet out from the Sun again, but in 2006, this changed again for a different reason. Pluto was no longer considered a planet. So let's go out to Pluto and then talk a little more about that. The last sculpture in this series is Pluto, a tiny planet, smaller than the Earth's moon. It was the first object to be discovered in the Kuiper Belt region. However, beginning in the 1990s, questions were starting to be asked about its status as a planet. The figures on its actual size trended downwards as they became more precise, and its largest moon? Well, it's half as big as Pluto itself. In fact, the centre of gravity between Pluto and Charon doesn't actually lie below the surface of Pluto, so they're actually kind of orbiting each other. This sentiment kind of grew over time, but the final nail in the coffin occurred when Eris was discovered, believed to be larger than Pluto. Named after the Greco-Roman goddess of strife and discord, this it certainly did cause. Pluto was redeclared a dwarf planet in 2006, as it appeared to be more similar to other Kuiper Belt objects than the other planets in the solar system. Later measurements showed that Eris was actually marginally smaller than it, but the argument still stood. And that's the planetary part of our solar system. Technically, our solar system extends to the entire region out to the outer edge of the Oort cloud, about halfway to Proxima Centauri. Nearby the Sun, we find a model of Proxima Centauri, the next nearest star to our Sun. Now, if you think it's strange, because surely it can't be that close to the Sun, you're measuring it wrong. It's not the distance from here to there, it's the distance from here all the way around the world and back to there, plus another 700 kilometers or so, and close enough. And that is the nearest other star to us.